Hi everyone, this is Johannes. I'm a researcher in economics, and today I'm going to show you how to use Julia to study economic inequality and taxation in the United States. And I'm going to do so using the Taxsim.jl package. As a brief introduction to my research, I generated a plot showing the evolution of before-tax household incomes in the United States since 1960. And as you can see here, there has been a widening gap between high and low incomes starting in around 1980. In fact, this trend is now considered to be one of the major social challenges facing the United States today. A natural question then is to ask, to what extent has the income tax system leveled out those differences? So what is the evolution of after-tax incomes? Unfortunately, there is a considerable roadblock to giving an empirical answer to this question. Survey data, such as the ones I used to generate the graph you just saw, do not contain after-tax incomes. And so the only option around this problem is to impute income taxes paid using information from the US tax code, such as the marginal tax rates of different tax brackets. And this is precisely where Taxsim.jl comes into play. And as this package connects Julia to Taxsim, which is the tax calculator of the National Bureau of Economic Research, I'll first give you a brief introduction to this program, and I'll also show you how you can import household before tax income data into Julia. I'll be working with census and American community survey data today, but as you will see, my steps can be modified to work on any other data set such as the CPS or the BSID. From the data I'll work with, I'll then select a sample and put it into a format which Taxsim requires for tax imputation. And then finally, using Taxsim.jl, I'll construct a measure of after-tax incomes, which we can then compare to the graph you already saw. All right, let's head over to the Taxsim website. All right, so here we are at the website of Taxsim. Here in these boxes, you can see the input variables which Taxsim requires, for example, the marital status of a tax filer, the number and ages of dependents, as well as wage and salary incomes, obviously. Down here, you see the output variables of Taxsim. And the two variables we're going to work with today are variable number 4, which is the federal income tax liability, and variable number 6, which is the so-called FICA tax, that is the sum of Medicare and Social Security taxes. Now, this service, Taxsim, is provided and maintained by Daniel Feenberg, who works at the NBER. He's a fantastic researcher and extremely knowledgeable about the US income tax code. So if you have any project for which you think Taxsim could be useful, reach out to him. Now, to get our microdata on before tax household income data, let's head over to IPAMS and log into the USA data section here. I'm already logged in, so we can directly check which variables and samples I selected for today's talk. Let's click here to get into the extract description. And as you see here, I selected samples from 1960 to 2019. And here are the variables I selected, the most important being the wage and salary income. All right, so now everything that's left to do is to download this CSV file and to head over to Julia. All right, here we are. I'm first loading a bunch of packages, including Taxsim. I'm specifying where we save the data file, and I'm also including two utility functions. Now, using the CSV and data frames packages, I am importing the data, and I'm selecting only the variables which we need for today's exercise. Now, here in line 26, out of the entire data set, which consists of about 34 million observations, as you can see down here, I'm selecting a sample which we can compare consistently across years. So here I'm focusing on people with some attachment to the labor force. For example, I'm excluding retirees and also people who are still in education. Now in line 29, I am converting this sample into a format which meets Taxsim's input requirements. So basically I'm filling the boxes you just saw on the Taxsim website. I'll show you the function I'm using for that purpose. So as you see here, I'm using the group by function of the data frames package. And the reason is because this really makes sure that we get good speed here, since we have to apply this function to several million of observations. And we do need to take a whole bunch of steps here. So yeah, I recommend working with the data frame package, since this gives you good speed. All right, and then I am only focusing here on married couples, again, for consistency purposes. And now finally down here in line 34, we are now sending our Taxsim input data frame, which you can see here, up to the Taxsim server. The server imputes the income tax information, and we're directly downloading this information into another data frame object. And now here in the remainder of the program, I use this information to construct a measure for after-tax incomes. I compute the percentile values. I'm normalizing everything to the 1960 level. And here I am generating the plot you already saw, which only shows the before-tax household incomes. And now in the final lines of this program, I am overlaying this plot with the information on the after-tax incomes, which we just obtained from Taxsim. So let's have a look at this plot. And here is the graph we just generated. So in addition to the before tax household incomes, we now also have after tax incomes as dashed lines. And as this plot illustrates, people with low incomes pay relatively little in taxes because the discrepancy between before tax incomes and after tax incomes is very small. And even though this gap opens up quickly as incomes increase, there are still considerable differences also in after tax incomes. And in fact, these differences are very persistent over time. And before I conclude, I would like to point out two aspects which we haven't considered today, which are highly relevant in this context. The first one is the role of transfer programs. These are income support programs which go primarily towards people with low incomes. So if we were to consider them in the graph we just generated, the picture would look a bit different, in particular for people with low incomes. Second aspect I want to flag here are non-federal taxes, such as taxes on sales and excise taxable goods, as well as property and to some extent also income taxes. We know from research that those are the majority of taxes paid by people with low incomes, so considering them also might affect this picture. All right, thanks a lot for watching. I hope you enjoyed.